Hi, my name is Luis Fonan, and I am the CEO and co-founder of Duolingo. And today I'm going to tell you about the state of our company. But before doing that, I want to thank you all for spending time with us. Everything we do it for you. So we're very happy and honored that you've been here with us. Now, Duocon has become a really huge thing. Last year was the first time we did it entirely online. We had a lot of people with us. We had 118,000 live attendees from more than 152 countries. And so it was a huge event. We're hoping that this year is going to be even bigger than last year. And we're also super happy that we're going to have Duocon again next year. It's Duocon 2022. We are hopefully going to be able to have it in person in New York City. But of course, for those of you who cannot make it, it's going to be entirely streamed live so that you can, you know, be with us throughout the day. So next year, Duocon 2022, very happy about it. You know, when I talk about Duolingo, the most important thing to know about Duolingo is our mission. Every time I talk about Duolingo, I like to bring up our mission. Our mission is to develop the best education in the world and to make it universally available. There's a couple of things to say about this. Notice that our mission is not about language learning. Even though everybody knows us for a language learning product, our mission is more general. It's about all of education. The way I see it, the two biggest problems that humanity has are global warming and economic inequality. We are working on reducing economic inequality, and we believe that the best way to reduce economic inequality is through education. Our mission is not just about language learning, it's more general, and you'll see, as I'm going to talk about at the end of this talk, we are expanding to teaching other subjects and not just languages. But the last 10 years, the main thing we've been doing is teaching languages, and I'm gonna talk mostly about languages, of course. Now, as a company, our strategy, we're working on five things. These are the main five things we work on as a company, and they are these. The first one is we are working on growing our number of learners. By now, we have about 40 million monthly active learners. We are by far the largest language learning platform in the world. We're the most popular way to learn languages in the world. But of course, we're not done. There's many more people in the world, and so we are continuing to reach more and more people, so we're growing our number of learners. What we do to grow our number of learners is, of course, making Duolingo more and more enjoyable so that people use it a lot, so that people don't stop using it, and so that people tell their friends. So we work a lot on that. Another big area that we work on is in teaching better. Of course, the ultimate goal of Duolingo is to teach you languages, and so we work a lot on teaching better. The largest team at Duolingo is the team that is dedicated to teaching better. I'm going to talk a lot about some of the initiatives that we have, and you've heard a lot during Duocon, but really, the main thing, the biggest thing we work on is teaching people better. The third kind of big initiative that we work on is growing our number of paid subscribers. These are the people that subscribe to Duolingo Plus. Most of our users use Duolingo entirely for free. In fact, only 5% of our users pay to subscribe. However, those people that pay to subscribe really help because they support the rest of the users, and they really are the ones who support this entire operation. So we're very thankful for the people who subscribe, but we are working a lot on basically adding features and making the subscription more and more enticing so that we can fund the rest of the initiatives. So we're working a lot on growing our subscribers. The fourth big thing that we're working on is trying to become the proficiency standard for how much people know a language. So today, if somebody asks you how much French do you know, for example, the common answers that people give are, I am intermediate in French. That's just not a very good answer because, well, it doesn't mean much. Another common answer is, I took 4 years of French in high school. Also, doesn't mean much. What we would like to do, we would like it to be the case that in a few years, when somebody asks you how much French do you know, you say, I'm a Duolingo 65 or I'm a Duolingo 85 or something. So we're working on adding a proficiency score to the app so that anybody can talk about their proficiency in the language. And one of the big efforts that we have on this is also the Duolingo English test. We have a standardized English proficiency test that you have heard about. We're using that score, and we're going to try to translate that score to many other languages, and the hope is that we can become the proficiency standard in a few years. And we're working a lot on that. And then the last big initiative that we're working on is expanding beyond language learning. We already launched Duolingo ABC, which is an app to teach early literacy, but we're going to be working on other subjects that I'm going to talk about. We're in teaching other subjects, and I'm going to talk about that. Now, let me tell you a little bit about some changes to the product that we've been, features that we've been adding and work that we've been doing on the product, because these are just some very exciting initiatives. The first thing that I'm going to talk about are our efficacy and just how well we teach, and you know, also why efficacy is important. Well, in particular, efficacy is very important because it's ultimately what we're trying to do. Our mission is to develop the best education in the world and make it universally available. So you know, we're really just trying to teach better. We're very happy with our efficacy. I'm going to talk a little bit about these results, but the most important thing to understand, or the first thing to understand, is that our courses are aligned to the Common European Framework of Reference. Some people call it CEFR or CEFR. And what the Common European Framework of Reference does is it gives you kind of six buckets of how well you know a language. There's really a seventh bucket, which is you don't know the language. So it's you don't know the language, then there's A1, A2, then there's B1, B2, C1, C2. So the A levels are the beginner levels, the B levels are the intermediate levels, and the C levels are the advanced ones. So C2, for example, is somebody that is just very, very highly proficient in a language. That's not even enough to just be a native speaker. Many native speakers of a language are actually level C1 and not C2. C2 is native speaker, and also you have a really good command of the language. The way I think about it is kind of Obama level speaking. It's just somebody that just speaks really, really well. The A levels, of course, are just beginners, but you know, already if you speak a language to level A2, you can do a lot of things. So for example, you can ask for directions, you can have simple conversations, you can probably buy things, etc. At Duolingo, we try really hard to teach people to level B2. B2 is a level that is enough for people to get a knowledge job in that language. So for example, if you wanted to get a job at Duolingo, we speak English here inside the company, and your English level was B2, that would be perfectly fine. And that's true of most companies. Knowledge jobs, you know, B2 is enough for knowledge jobs. And what we're trying to do with Duolingo is teach in all our languages to teach to level B2. We're not there yet for all our languages, but that is, you know, the thing that we're working on really hard. You know, last year at Duocon, we actually had a whole presentation about our effectiveness. And this is a study that we're very proud of. Here's what we did, just for those of you who didn't see it last year. The study that we ran was as follows. We got people who started learning on Duolingo who specifically said they had either no prior proficiency or very low prior proficiency in either French or Spanish. So these were people that basically didn't know either French or Spanish. And then we had them learn on Duolingo. And then whenever they reached Unit 5, when they completed Unit 5 on Duolingo, which is about halfway down the Spanish or French course, we asked them, did you use anything other than Duolingo to learn? And of those who only used Duolingo, we said, okay, so these are people who were learning Spanish on Duolingo, came to Duolingo without knowing any Spanish or French. They learned and they didn't use anything other than Duolingo. To those people, we gave them a standardized test to figure out how much of the language they knew. And then we compared their scores with scores of people who, rather than learning on Duolingo, were learning by taking university classes. And what we found is that, you know, people who study on Duolingo learn the equivalent of people who had taken 4 university semesters of either French or Spanish. But what's most amazing is that it took about half the time for people to learn that on Duolingo. So that's something that we're very proud of. Now, this study that we presented last year measured two things. It measured listening proficiency and reading proficiency. The reason we measure those two first is because those are the easiest to measure, and it's, you know, kind of what everybody compares language knowledge with. But of course, we want to measure other types of proficiency, for example, speaking proficiency. Now, this year, I'm very happy to announce the results of a study that we just ran. You can find it, of course, on duolingo.com/efficacy. A study that we just ran to measure speaking skills. And so what we did here is pretty similar to what we did for listening and reading skills, in that we took people who had no prior proficiency in either Spanish or French, used Duolingo and finished Unit 5. So this is kind of the first part of the course, the beginner part of the course. Now, internally, Unit 5 for us, if you finish Unit 5, what we expect for you to be able to know is A2 of a language. That's the internal kind of what we try to achieve. And so what we did here is we took these people who finished Unit 5 and then we measured how good their speaking skills were. And what we found is that over 50% of the people who finished Unit 5 had speaking skills of at least A2. So you can see here, in both Spanish or French, about 40% of the people had speaking skills of A2, and then a few more. So in Spanish was another maybe 20-some percent had speaking skills of B2 or better, and then in French, so another about 10% had speaking skills of either B1 or better. In total, for both languages, more than 50% of the people had the speaking skills that we expected. So that's something that we're very proud of. So that basically means that Duolingo is very good at teaching you speaking. Now, in addition to that, we're in fact improving how well we teach speaking. And you know, let me tell you about a few things that we're working on that we're adding to the app, not just with speaking, but with other things. The first one, of course, is with speaking. We have started adding conversation lessons. You can see them on iOS so far. We're going to be adding them soon to Android. And these are in certain languages, in French and in Spanish, we have these conversational lessons where the idea is that we take everything you've learned on Duolingo, and then here we get you to practice it with something that feels like a very real conversation, where you may be either asking for directions or buying something or eating at a restaurant. And so these are these very real scenarios, and you get to have an entire conversation where you speak one part of it. And whenever you don't pronounce something well, we try to really drill down the pronunciation, et cetera. And the idea is for you to really practice real world conversations with this. The hope is that with this, you're even going to be able to improve your speaking even more than what we had with before. So that's something that we're very proud of. Another big product that we're very proud of is a feature we call Hoots. You can see it on the web right now. It's available for French. Pretty soon it's going to be on iPhones, and we're going to be rolling it out to all the different languages. And this is a feature that tries to improve how well you write. So the idea is to practice your writing. What it is it's a daily writing prompt that we automatically grade, and we tell you whether you said something right or wrong, and whether you made any mistakes in your writing. So you can imagine that every day we may ask you things like, what did you have for breakfast today? Or please describe your hometown, or what's your ideal vacation? And the idea is that you have to write a short paragraph in the language that you're learning, and automatically, through artificial intelligence, we tell you whether you wrote it well. And if you didn't write it well, we try to give you corrections for how to really write it. Now, one of the reasons why it's taken us so long to get here is because developing the artificial intelligence to be able to grade free written text has been pretty difficult. But we're very proud of what we have so far. And here you can see more screenshots. The idea is that you're writing, and also we give you recommendations about how to write certain things. There's a lot of help that we give you if you don't know how to write a given word. You can just look it up right there, and then it'll tell you how to write it. And the idea is that you can write really these relatively long paragraphs, especially for beginners, and then we can grade the whole thing without ever using a human. So this is something that we're very proud of and will really help you practice your writing. Another thing that I'm very happy to announce is that we're going to be adding 5 new languages pretty soon. These are very highly requested languages. They're for English speakers, so people who already speak English are going to be able to learn 5 more languages. The first one is Tagalog. We're also going to be adding 2 South African languages, Zulu and Xhosa. We're going to be adding Maori, and we're also going to be adding Haitian Creole. You're going to see us be adding languages every single year. The 5 that we decided to add are these, and we're very excited by it. Another big initiative that we have for this year that we're very proud of is a full revamp of Duolingo for schools. So Duolingo is used in a lot of schools. According to our best estimates, approximately 40% of language classrooms in the United States use Duolingo. We have a tool called Duolingo for Schools, which is for teachers. The idea is that students all use Duolingo normally as they would, but Duolingo for Schools allows teachers to track what their students are learning. You can find Duolingo for Schools at schools.duolingo.com. That tool has been there, but this year we are doing a complete overhaul of this tool. It will look a lot better. We have a massively simplified onboarding flow and also massively simplified student account creation and a lot more new features. So the hope is that teachers are just going to have a much better time using Duolingo in schools than they did before. And that's something that we're very excited about because we know how much Duolingo can help in schools, especially when schools are not fully in person. So very happy with this. Another big thing, of course, I already referenced this, is Duolingo ABC. Last year, we launched an app. We talked about it, called Duolingo ABC, which is a literacy app, an early literacy app. This is for kids ages roughly 3 to 6 to learn how to read. Right now, it only exists in English. So these are kids who already know English. We're not trying to teach them English. They already know English. but we're trying to teach them how to read in English. The app has been growing very nicely, and since we launched it last year, it has received a number of major awards. For example, it was chosen as one of Time Magazine's best inventions of 2020. It won the Kidscreen Best Learning App. It won a Webby Award. So it's won a lot of awards, and it's because it's a free way to teach how to read. And our goal with this app is really to reduce worldwide illiteracy. It's crazy that today, many children around the world don't learn how to read or don't learn how to read very well. For example, there's 1 billion adults in the world that are illiterate. We're hoping to combat that with an app that is free that can be used throughout the world to, you know, teach kids how to read. And so that's something that we're very excited about. You're going to see us put a lot more effort on this, and you know, the app is going to continue getting better. And actually, this brings us to one, you know, one of the things that I talked about that we're working on as a company, which is expanding beyond just teaching foreign languages. A big thing that we're doing is teaching literacy. We're also going to be teaching math. And the idea is that we're trying to find subjects that improve people's opportunities in life. So obviously, teaching somebody how to read is massively, you know, can massively improve somebody's life. We're also working on a math app to teach elementary school math. This is kind of how it's going to look like. The basic idea is it's going to be pretty similar to Duolingo in that it's going to be a gamified, fun way to learn math. In fact, we're going to be using a lot of the same technology that we're using with Duolingo to teach languages. We're going to be using it to teach elementary school math. And so we're very proud of this. This app hopefully will come out to the public next year. And again, it's something that we're extremely proud of. So what's next? We're going to continue, of course, expanding to teaching other subjects. I talked about literacy, I talked about math. Our mission is to develop the best education in the world and make it universally available. And you know, as long as there are people in the world who can't read, or there are people in the world who don't know basic math, or there are people in the world who want to continue learning things, we still have a lot of work to do. One of our operating principles inside the company at Duolingo is we haven't won yet. And I really believe we haven't won yet until we have taught everything that there is to teach. So we're going to be continuing to expand the subjects that we teach. We're going to continue working really hard on this. And that's it for Duocon 2021. We have people, you know, for all of you watching us all over the world, thank you. Thank you for spending some time with us and hearing about our company and all of our different initiatives. Also, thank you to all the speakers. This has been a great conference. And I hope to see you in person next year in New York City, or if not in person, online next year. And thank you all for watching.